recipient of this year's Valedictorian Award is an exceptional person amongst the class full of, in my opinion, really wonderful young people. A former colleague of mine who's a math teacher, Bob, used an expression to define wealth in our many drives to home and back from work, and he'd say, I am a rich man, I have two shirts. This year I've had two grade 12 classes, both in the second semester, so I'm feeling very fortunate and very rich indeed. It is an honor to be asked to introduce the valedictorian. Now, valedictorian is defined as the student who has the highest academic average, and that person has the honor of addressing their graduating class. Our valedictorian does indeed have an impressive academic record. I spoke to teachers and they reported numbers like 96, 97, 98, 98, 100. And as a biology teacher, I thought, wow, Virginia has great systolic blood pressure readings. So, thank you for that. After all, she's a pretty good athlete. Her cardiac conditioning is excellent, but no, those are not blood pressures measured in millimeters of mercury. These are percentages in courses like art, math, biology, AP English, and psychology. I recall back when she was in grade 10 in the good old days of the provincial exams. Virginia scored a 98% in English, a 99% in math, and a 99% in science. And I do not recall ever seeing a 99% in a science 10 exam at Poppy ever. You need to bring some serious reasoning and critical thinking skills to that exam. But even though I have to address her academic success, I'm conflicted because there's a lot more to our valedictorian than high academic achievement. She is extremely humble and much more likely to compliment her classmates and teammates than acknowledge her own accomplishments. She is reflective and very, very observant of the smallest details and alternative facts that I might make up in class to get me by, usually come back to haunt me weeks or months after the fact, and that makes me look bad. I'm used to that. She's tenacious when she feels her answer on an exam has not been properly evaluated. So do not mistake her for a wallflower. She is very brave. There's no topic she will not discuss, no questions she won't ask, no place she will not visit, and no authority figure that she will not challenge if she deems that she or anyone close to her has been unfairly treated. Virginia's determination and resilience are impressive. All basketball season, I watched her play on taped ankles, and even though she limped into the gym and she limped out of the gym, during the game you couldn't tell she was hurt. I watched her play 5 games in 3 days in Nelson at the BC Championships, and even though she was the defender, she had to take all the corner kicks, which meant that when everyone else was getting a rest, when the ball was out of play, she was running the length of the field. And in rugby, you'll see her make a fierce tackle, get up, make a second tackle, and the next player passing the ball down the field. Now, it's not all perfect. She can be very grumpy at 6:15 in the morning at basketball practice, which is likely, and she's more likely to be late than up to class on time. But that's probably because she was awake until 2 a.m. that same day, preparing for an exam after a musical theater rehearsal and a basketball game the previous night. She's a talented artist. She can sing, she can dance, she can act major roles in Footloose and Guys and Dolls. She can paint, and she draws shockingly powerful images. She's devoted hundreds of hours to local community services, and has traveled to Mexico and Rwanda to provide assistance to those folks who are less fortunate than us. And so today I feel very fortunate and very rich to have taught and coached such a great group of grade 12 students. And with Virginia in my class every year for 5 years at Poppy, I feel like I've got more than 2 shirts. I have a closet full of shirts. Parents, staff, honored guests, and students, your valedictorian for 2017, Virginia Ocean Nikkel.
We are finally here. I'm going to take a minute and make the adults in the audience feel old, but But then again, we might be the last grad class to make you feel young. Before you on the stage is the last group of graduates born in the 90s, the last group of kids to cross the stage that still have a 19 at the start of their birth year. Many exciting things happened in the year 1999. On April 1st, Nevitt was established as a Canadian territory. I'm surprised no one yelled April Fools, but I guess we Canadians will have none of it. In May 1st, 1999 was the debut of SpongeBob SquarePants and Nickelodeon. The legacy of SpongeBob and his faithful companion, Patrick the Star, will inspire us always. It was also the year that, according to Mr. Allen, the nicest kid in school was born, Colby Cock. Since then, we've survived the Millennium Bug, elementary school, Ebola, dabbing, and Mr. Penner. These people in front of you today are some of the most kind and caring individuals I know. Whether they find their place on the backfield, the ice rink, in the classroom, the shop, on the stage, or in the gym, they each bring something special to our grad class. Upon entering the classroom, you'll probably hear Casey Yak sassing off a teacher, out of love, of course, or find Kelsey Greening's desk mysteriously empty, even though she's at school the block before, or find Felix Bolgaro up on the board in physics, describing every single event of World War II off the top of his head. You might even find students hard at work, but that's a bit rarer of an occasion. One thing that you will be sure to find is a group of students who love to crack jokes, are willing to dress up as frat boys for spirit days, are always down for a good time, and will genuinely accept those around them. We've had 5 years to grow close, to make mistakes, to make memories, and learn more about who we are. Now, I'm going to share a story with you. A young boy who was born without a left arm was sent to doodle lessons by his mother in a bid to help with his confidence. He began taking lessons with an old Japanese master, and every practice session, the master taught the boy one drill, just one technique over and over again. Every so often, the one-armed boy would see the other students learning different techniques and ask the master why he wasn't learning anything else. The master always replied, just focus on the one throw. Keep practicing. Several months later, it was the state judo championships, and the old master entered the young boy. The young boy was terrified. The first match began, and the one-armed boy grabbed his opponent, and to the shock of all the spectators, easily flipped him to the ground. Instant win. The second round was a little harder, but the one-armed boy again pulled off the technique, the only technique he knew, and won. The third and fourth round amazingly went the same way, and the young boy found himself in the tournament final facing a much bigger, much stronger, and tougher opponent who had won the tournament for 3 straight years. The young boy was overmatched, it seemed. The referee and the organizers of the tournament spoke to the master and asked him if he wanted to withdraw his student. No, said the master, we will fight. As the final match began, the entire crowd were on the edge of their seat. The opponent stepped and grabbed the young one-armed boy and pulled him towards him. For a second, it looked as if it was all over. But then the one-armed boy reached with his right hand, stepped in, and boom, he threw his opponent flat on his back to win the match. The crowd went wild. The one-armed boy was the state judo champion. On the drive home, the young boy asked his teacher, was this a setup? Did they just let me win because I only have one arm? I only know one technique. These guys won't enter. The teacher replied, no, you won fair and square, but there are 2 reasons. You won because you mastered one of the most devastating techniques in judo, and the only known way to defend against that throw is to grab your opponent's left arm. What had appeared to be an incredible weakness was in fact his greatest strength. Each one of you has gifts and abilities, most that you may not even realize. Some of you may have a variety of strengths, and some of you may excel in a specific area, but I want you to know that each of your gifts will have a purpose beyond these doors. Maybe one day, being born in the 1900s will make us feel old, but for now, as we celebrate an ending, we are also at the beginning of a new journey. As you leave today, remember this. Be strong and courageous, encourage one another, build each other up, and do everything in love. Thank you and good luck, graduates of 2017.